Hello, my name is Lorenzo Noya, and today I'll be talking about the chemical element that could potentially, and hopefully I say, save our energy crisis. Now I'm talking about helium, specifically an isotope of helium. So an isotope, to put it in a simplistic way, is a version of helium. Helium-3 is the isotope I'll be talking about, and it has two protons and one neutron. And why do we care? Well, it's really important to understand that isotope 3, when undergoing nuclear fusion, is one of the only particles that remains stable and does not create radioactive nor toxic waste, and creates an incredible amount of weight of energy, an immense amount of energy. In fact, okay. So this is an image of helium-3. As you can see, we can see the two protons and one neutron. And as I was saying, helium-3, when undergoing nuclear fusion, can create 19 megawatts energy of power. And like, what does that mean? We hear this unit, 19 megawatts years of energy. And well, quite frankly, I also didn't know, but then I went and searched it up. And to put it simply, 1 megawatt year of energy is enough energy that if we get for 24 hours a day, 365 days, so an entire year, 1 million watts of energy, we would have 1 megawatt year of energy, which can power about 1,000 homes. 19 megawatt years of energy could power more or less 19,000 homes, which is a lot. And what's the big catch? You know, we have this infinite amount of energy, and why are we not using it? It creates no waste, it's perfect. Well, the problem is that helium-3 is extremely rare on Earth. Like, matter of fact, the only place where it's abundant is in our mantle, and I've never been there, but the conditions aren't great, you know? So another way that we could artificially create helium-3 is by using nuclear warheads. Inside of nuclear warheads, we have this other isotope called the tritium. And tritium, when undergoing a nuclear explosion, creates helium-3. Like, it doesn't create, but it will form helium-3. But we cannot also just go around launching nuclear weapons around the world just to get this helium, right? So where else could we find it? Well, so we shoot for the stars, we aim for the moon, and that's exactly where we can find the incredible amounts of helium-3. But why is it in the moon, out of all places? Well, Earth has an atmosphere around it. Luckily, if not, we wouldn't be here. And this atmosphere protects us from a lot of things, including solar beams. Well, solar beams are basically beams of particles that are shot from the sun. And the sun shoots a lot of helium-3. It's constantly emitting it. And the moon does not have an atmosphere. So during the billions and billions of years, the surface of the moon has been exposed to these particles of helium, which have basically gone all over it. And helium, so now how do we get to the moon, right? Like, obviously we've been there, but how do we extract the helium from the moon? Well, it would be amazing to have, you know, Optimus Prime going around, getting the helium, bringing it back, and yeah, it's easy, but that's not how it works. We have to send other machines like the Mark Miner too. So to put it in a simplistic form, the Mark Miner, underneath it, it has a heating pod that heats the solar dust under it, the lunar dust, under it, and extracts the helium from the solar dust. And only one space shuttle of helium could basically power up the entire, which is 23 tons, could power up the entire United States for 1 year, which is quite incredible, if you ask me. And so, like, if we talk about money, is all of this profitable? Well, it's super profitable. Like, 1 ton of helium equivalents to $3 billion, which is a lot. Obviously, if correctly undergoing nuclear fusion, which is the main problem. But the moon has approximately 1 million tons of helium-3 on it. So, like, it could give us energy for basically millennia. Clean, renewable energy that would help us in every possible way. But now, the real problem is the nuclear fusion. So, like, I tend like to say nuclear fusion, but I'm going to explain what it is for the sake of it. So, inside, nuclear fusion mainly occurs inside of stars. So, for example, our sun. And stars and suns kind of cheat their way through this because they have so much mass and they're so dense that in the core of a sun, you have atoms which are stripped of their electrons. When an atom is stripped of its electrons, it's turned into subatomic particles, so protons, neutrons. And these protons and neutrons, especially protons, the nuclei of the atom, is moving, and it's moving at a super fast speed due to the heat inside of the sun, which is like 14 million degrees Celsius. And so these protons, which they repel normally because they're both positive charge, they're forced to get together even if they are not meant to be, and creating a new nuclei, which creates incredible amounts of energy. Now, the main problem with this is that we cannot build a star on Earth, right? It's really difficult, but we actually have created, like, this is an example. This is the ITER nuclear fusion reactor, and this is like a person to put a comparison on how massive all of this would be. And the main problem with fusion nuclear reactors is that even if they work, the energy needed to input is not as much as the output. So it's like not cost efficient. And this is one of the main setbacks as well, as we're not doing this right now, because this does not properly work. So at the end of the day, it really comes down, it's a billion-dollar gamble. Because if we're able to make this work, then obviously we could basically become like a space-dominating species and have infinite amount of energy forever and think about other problems. But if we don't, like, a lot of people lose a lot of money, firstly, and most importantly, we would be wasting so much time, research, and also money on things that could have been done for other energy sources that we already know that work. So my estimate for the future is that, according to the governments of the world, they have started to invest a lot of money in lunar exploration again. Big part of this is because of helium-3. And because they want to find a way to extract it and use it as an energy source, since it's basically a treasure just lying not that close from us, but lying in our reach at least. And my estimate is that we could be able to build a functioning nuclear reactor, and that could save us from ever needing to think about energy consumption and all of its problems. And as Lorenzo Noya, this was my presentation on helium-3.